Here is the little nook where I watch a bazillion screeners and DVDs for work, for pleasure. Here is a cute little advertisement for Picnic starring Kim Novak, one of my brides from the 1950s. Other brides are Doris Day, Jane Russell, Susanna York. Usually someone becomes a bride when she's either dead or she is still lingering but has been somewhat forgotten. Like, everybody remembers Marilyn Monroe, but not many people have such fond memories of Jane Russell.
Can you talk about Susanna York a little bit?
Well, Susanna York is a bride, first and foremost, because of her incredible performance as Childie in The Killing of Sister George, which will be screened at Walter Reed February 28th. And I have the great honor of introducing the film, which is rarely screened, so very much looking forward to that. The first time I saw The Killing of Sister George, I was visiting dear friends of mine in Austin, Texas, rabid cinephiles. This must have been in 93 or 94, and they had a copy on VHS. And this was years before I started writing about film, but this was an experience that I had watching this film, where I thought there's just so much to say, there's so much happening. Can I somehow make a career out of writing about these things that are really blowing my mind, in which so much is happening?
So we're talking about double features, and Melissa, what would be your pick for an ideal double feature?
To me, of all the rich possibilities that there are for combining two films, to me, the most felicitous pairing, one that I would travel thousands of miles to see, would be a double feature of Howard Hawks's Gentlemen Prefer Blondes from 1953 and Jacques Demy's The Young Girls of Rochefort from 1967. Toward the end of The Young Girls of Rochefort, there's a scene in which Catherine Deneuve and Françoise Dorléac sing a song. That number is almost exactly like the one that opens Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, in which a sequin curtain opens and both sets of women in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes and The Young Girls of Rochefort are wearing these red sequin dresses. As amazing as the chemistry is between these two sisters, Catherine Deneuve and Françoise Dorléac, they cannot dance at all. They're trying very hard, extremely hard, but because it's such a loving and sincere homage, it just makes that moment, even for all of its clumsiness and its failings, all that more precious, I think. And I think with Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, what was so fascinating to me about this film was that it was a musical in which men were essentially superfluous, and I found that really fascinating. And the rapport between Marilyn Monroe and Jane Russell is so special and so really sexy in many ways. There's just so much pulchritude in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, just these big bosoms and all these curves. And Hawks is really playing with that, and they're dressed in these really kind of revealing outfits. And in The Young Girls of Rochefort, Catherine Deneuve and Françoise Dorléac are very much, they have the bodies of that were popular in the, I mean, they definitely have these very Twiggy-like figures. So there's something about them that seems more fragile, not quite as sexy. I keep using this word vulgar for Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, but I mean it as the highest compliment. So it's these kind of raunchy reds and dirty blacks and foxy blues. So these darker, perhaps more, corporeal colors. Whereas when you think of The Young Girls of Rochefort, also a beautiful orgiastic vision of color, but it's much more, it's pastels, it's lime greens, it's light pinks, it's these sherbet yellows. There's one great scene where Françoise Dorléac and Catherine Deneuve come out in these gorgeous peignoirs, but they're these azures and delicate pinks. Maybe, I mean, again, with the benefit of hindsight, one could look at the male performances, or specifically those by George Chakiris and Grover Dale in The Young Girls of Rochefort, is maybe perhaps as being coded a tiny bit gay. They're dancing in the cafe, which is run by the great Daniel Darieux, who plays the mother of Catherine and Francoise, they're wearing just these crazy booties. I mean, again, those could have been the male dance fashions of 1967. Who knows? There's this there's this incredible scene in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes in which, how would you describe it? Or I don't know what the term would be. In which Jane Russell has to pretend to be Marilyn Monroe's character, Lorelai Lee. And she goes on trial and affects all of her mannerisms, dyes her hair blonde, says things like, "Judge, a girl like I would never swear." And it just becomes so ridiculous. And then the craziest moment is when the heat is really on. The lawyers are asking all these questions. She doesn't know how to get out of this jam. And so she just breaks into song, takes off her cape, and then she's wearing some skimpy little outfit, and then performs Diamonds Are a Girl's Best Friend, which we had just seen the real Marilyn Monroe do a few moments ago. And so to me, that moment, again, exemplifies the kind of celebration of these two women, of their closeness, of their kind of magical, mysterious bond that one would substitute for the other.
Do you think that Gentlemen Prefer Blondes is like a parody of femininity or a celebration of femininity, or maybe both? What do you think?
Oh, I think it's definitely a celebration of femininity. And I mean, Marilyn Monroe is playing the stereotypical dumb blonde, but much in the way that Judy Holliday did, you can definitely see the genius behind the dumb blonde performance. Her timing is impeccable, especially in her scenes with Jane Russell. And all of their musical numbers, whether together or separate, are just such showstoppers that you can really only read it as a celebration.